This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Published on the 15th of April 1755 and written by Samuel Johnson, a dictionary of the English language, sometimes published as Johnson's Dictionary, is among the most influential dictionaries in the history of the English language. There was dissatisfaction with the dictionaries of the period, so in June 1746 a group of London booksellers contracted Johnson to write a dictionary for the sum of 1,500 guineas £1,575, equivalent to about £220,000 in 2016. Johnson took nearly 9 years to complete the work. Although he had claimed he could finish it in three remarkably, he did so single-handedly, with only clerical assistance to copy out the illustrative quotations that he had marked in books. Johnson produced several revised editions during his life until the completion of the Oxford English Dictionary 173. 3 Reception History 31 Initial Reception 32 Criticism 33 Influence in Britain 34 Reputation Abroad 35 Influence in America 4 Folio and Abridged Editions 5 Modern Editions 6 Notes 7 References 8 External Links Background 100 years earlier, books had been regarded with something approaching veneration, but by the mid-18th century this was no longer the case. The rise of literacy among the general public, combined with the technical advances in the mechanics of printing and bookbinding, meant that for the first time, books, texts, maps, pamphlets and newspapers were widely available to the general public at a reasonable cost. Such an explosion of the printed word demanded a set pattern of grammar, definition, and spelling for those words. This could be achieved by means of an authoritative dictionary of the English language in 1746, a consortium of London's most successful printers, including Robert Dodsley and Thomas Longman. None could afford to undertake it alone, set out to satisfy and capitalise on this need by the ever-increasing reading and writing public. Johnson's dictionary was not the first English dictionary, nor even among the first dozen over the previous 150. Lingua Britannica Reformata 1749 and Ainsworth's Thesaurus Linguae Latinae 1737 are both significant, in that they define entries in separate senses, or aspects, of the word in English among others. John Cowell's Interpreter, a law dictionary, was published in 1607, Edward Phillips' The New World of English Words came out in 1658 and a dictionary of 40,000 words had been prepared in 1721 by Nathan Bailey, though none was as comprehensive in breadth or style as Johnson's. The problem with these dictionaries was that they tended to be little more than poorly organized and poorly researched glossaries of hard words, words that were technical, foreign, obscure or antiquated. But perhaps the greatest single fault of these early lexicographers was, as historian Henry Hitchings put it, that they failed to give sufficient sense of the English language as it appeared in use. In that sense, Dr. Johnson's dictionary was the first to comprehensively document the English lexicon. Johnson's preparation main article, Letter to Chesterfield. Johnson's dictionary was prepared at 17 Gough Square, London, an eclectic household, between the years of 1746 and 1755. By 1747 Johnson had written his plan of a dictionary of the English language, which spelled out his intentions and proposed methodology for preparing his document. He clearly saw benefit in drawing from previous efforts, and saw the process as a parallel to legal precedent possibly influenced by Cowell. I shall therefore, since the rules of style, like those of law, arise from precedents often repeated, collect the testimonies of both sides, and endeavor to discover and promulgate the decrees of custom, who has so long possessed, whether by right or by usurpation, the sovereignty of words. Johnson's plan received the patronage of Philip Stanhope, 4th Earl of Chesterfield, but not to Johnson's pleasure. Chesterfield did not care about praise, but was instead interested by Johnson's abilities. 7 years after first meeting Johnson to discuss the work, Chesterfield wrote 2 anonymous essays in The World that recommended the dictionary. He complained that the English language was lacking structure and argued, we must have recourse to the old Roman expedient in times of confusion, and chose a dictator upon this principle. I give my vote for Mr. Johnson to fill that great and arduous post. However, Johnson did not appreciate the tone of the essay, and he felt that Chesterfield had not made good on his promise to be the work's patron. In a letter, Johnson explained his feelings about the matter. 7 years, my lord, have now passed since I waited in your outward rooms or was repulsed from your door, during which time I have been pushing on my work through difficulties of which it is useless to complain, and have brought it at last to the verge of publication without one act of assistance, one word of encouragement, or one smile of favor. Such treatment I did not expect, for I never had a patron before. in which the words are deduced from their originals, and illustrated in their different significations by examples from the Bate writers to which are prefixed, A History of the Language, and An English Grammar by Samuel Johnson, A.M. in two volumes. Volume 1, the words Samuel Johnson and English Language were printed in red, the rest was printed in black. The preface and headings were set in 46. Shakespeare, Milton and Dryden, for example, opulence, wealth, riches, affluence, there in full opulence a banker dwelt, who all the joys and pangs of riches felt, his sideboard glittered with imagined plate, and his proud fancy held a vast estate. Jonathan Swift, furthermore, Johnson, unlike Bailey, added notes on a word's usage, rather than being merely descriptive unlike most modern lexicographers. Johnson introduced humor or prejudice into quite a number of his definitions. Among the best known are, excise, a hateful tax levied upon commodities and adjudged not by the common judges of property but wretches hired by those to whom excise is paid. Lexicographer, a writer of dictionaries, a harmless drudge that busies himself in tracing the original and detailing the signification of words. Oats, a grain which in England is generally given to horses, but in Scotland supports the people. A much less well-known example is, monsieur, a term of reproach for a Frenchman. He included whimsical little-known words, such as, writative, a word of Pope's, not to be imitated, increase of years makes men more talkative but less writative, to that degree I now write letters but of plain how days on a more serious level. Johnson's work showed a heretofore unseen meticulousness unlike all the proto-dictionaries that had come before. Painstaking care went into the completeness when it came not only to illustrations but also to definitions as well. Turn had 16 definitions with 15 illustrations. Time had 20 definitions with 14 illustrations. Put ran more than 5,000 words spread over 3 pages. Take had 134 definitions, running 8,000 words over 5 pages. The original goal was to publish the dictionary in 2 folio volumes, AK and LZ, but that soon proved unwieldy, unprofitable, and unrealistic. Subsequent printings ran to 4 volumes, even these formed a stack 10. So discouraging was the price that by 1784, 30 years after the first edition was published, when the dictionary had by then run through 5 editions, only about 6,000 copies were in circulation, an average sale of 200 books a year for 30 years. Johnson's etymologies would be considered poor by modern standards, and he gave little guide to pronunciation, one example being cough, a convulsion of the lungs, velicated by some sharp serosity it is pronounced cough. Much of his dictionary was prescriptivist. It was also linguistically conservative, advocating traditional spellings such as public rather than the simpler spellings that would be favored. 73. From the moment of its inception, to be Johnson's, and from the time of its completion it was Johnson's dictionary, his book and his property, his monument, his memorial. Immediately after publication, the dictionary was enthusiastically written up in important periodicals such as the London Magazine and, none too surprisingly, the Gentleman's Magazine. In the latter it received an 8-page notice. Reviews, such as they were, proved generous in tone. Of the less positive assessments, the only properly judicious one came from Adam Smith in the pro-Whig Edinburgh Review. He wished that Johnson had oftener passed his own censure upon those words which are not of approved use, though sometimes to be met with in authors of no mean name. Furthermore, Johnson's approach was not sufficiently grammatical. Despite the dictionary's critical acclaim, Johnson's general financial situation continued in its dismal fashion for some years after 1755. The image of Johnson racing to write Rasselas to pay for his mother's funeral, romantic hyperbole though it is, conveys the precariousness of his existence. Almost 4 years after his work on the dictionary was done, his financial uncertainties continued. He gave up the house in Gough Square in March 1759, probably for lack of funds. Yet, just as Johnson was plunging into another trough of despondency, the reputation of the dictionary at last brought reward. In July 1762, Johnson was granted a state pension of £300 a year by the 24-year-old monarch, George III. The pension did not make him rich, but it ensured he would no longer have to grub around for the odd guinea. Criticism as lexicography developed, faults were found with Johnson's work. From an early stage there were noisy detractors. Perhaps the loudest of them was John Horne. Took not content to pronounce it imperfect and faulty, he complained that it was one of the most idle performances ever offered to the public, that its author possessed not one single requisite for the undertaking, that its grammatical and historical parts were most truly contemptible performances, and that nearly one-third is as much the language of the Hottentots as of the English. Horace Walpole summed up for the unbelievers when he pronounced at the end of the 18th century, "I cannot imagine that Dr. Johnson's reputation will be very lasting. His dictionary was a surprising work for one man, but the task is too much for one man, and a society should alone pretend to publish a standard dictionary." Walpole's reservations notwithstanding, the admirers outnumbered the detractors, and the reputation of the dictionary was repeatedly boosted by other philologists, lexicographers, educationalists, and word detectives. Johnson's dictionary was made when etymology was largely based on guesswork. His classical leanings led him to prefer spellings that pointed to Latin or Greek sources, while his lack of sound scholarship prevented him from detecting their frequent errors. For example, he preferred the spelling ache over ache, as he wrongly thought it came from the Greek achos. Some of his spelling choices were also inconsistent. While retaining the Latin P in receipt, he left it out of deceit. He spelled Dane one way and disdain another. He spelled uphill but downhill, muckhill but dunghill, instill but distill, enthrall but disenthrall. Influence in Britain. Despite the criticisms, the influence of the dictionary was sweeping. Johnson established both a methodology for how dictionaries should be put together and a paradigm for how entries should be presented. Anyone who sought to create a dictionary, post-Johnson, did so in his shadow. In his History of the Oxford English Dictionary, Simon Winchester asserts of its 18th-century predecessor that by the end of the century every educated household had, or had access to, the great book. So firmly established did it swiftly become that any request for the dictionary would bring forth Johnson and none other. One asked for the dictionary, writes Winchester, much as one might demand the Bible. One of the first editors of the OED, James Murray, acknowledged that many of Johnson's explanations were adopted without change, for when his definition are correct, and his arrangement judicious, it seems to be expedient to follow him. In the end, the OED reproduced around 1,700 of Johnson's definitions, marking them simply J. Reputation abroad. Johnson influence was not confined to Britain and English. The president of the Florentine Academia declared that the dictionary would be a perpetual monument of fame to the author, an honor to his own country in particular, and a general benefit to the Republic of Letters. This was no empty commendation. Johnson's work served as a model for lexicographers abroad. It is no surprise that his friend Giuseppe Baretti chose to make the dictionary the model for his Italian-English Dictionary of 1760, and for his Spanish dictionary nearly two decades later. But there are numerous examples of influence beyond Johnson's own circle. His work was translated into French and German, and in 1777, when Ferdinando Botticelli published a pocket dictionary of Italian, French and English, the three languages side by side, his authorities for the French and Italian words were the works of the French and Italian academies. For the English he used Johnson. Influence in America. The dictionary was exported to America. The American adoption of the dictionary was a momentous event not just in its history, but in the history of lexicography for Americans in the second half of the 18th century. Johnson was the seminal authority on language, and the subsequent development of American lexicography was colored by his fame. For American lexicographers, the dictionary was impossible to ignore. America's two great 19th-century lexicographers, Noah Webster and Joseph Emerson Worcester, argued fiercely over Johnson's legacy in 1789, declared that Great Britain, whose children we are, and whose language we speak, should no longer be our standard, for the taste of her writers is already corrupted, and her language on the decline. Where Webster found fault with Johnson, Joseph Worcester saluted him. In 1846 he completed his Universal and Critical Dictionary of the English Language. He defended Johnson's work, arguing that from the time of its publication, has been, far more than any other, regarded as the standard for the language. Notwithstanding the evolution of lexicography in America, the dictionary has also played its part in the law, especially in the United States. Legislators are much occupied with ascertaining first meanings, with trying to secure the literal sense of their predecessors. Legislation. Often it is a matter of historicizing language. To understand a law, you need to understand what its terminology meant to its original architects. As long as the American Constitution remains intact, Johnson's dictionary will have a role to play in American law. Folio and abridged editions. Samuel Johnson's folio and abridged dictionaries, together close up of pages for M entries in the folio and abridged dictionaries of 1755 and 1756 by Samuel Johnson. Johnson's famous dictionary came out in two forms. The first was the 1755 folio edition, which came in two large volumes on 15 April. The folio Edition also features full literary quotes by those authors that Johnson quoted, such as Dryden and Shakespeare. It was followed a few weeks later by a second edition published in 165 weekly parts. The third edition was published in 1765, but it was the fourth, which came out in 1773, which included significant revisions by Johnson of the original work. The abridged edition came out in 1756 in 2 octavo volumes with entries, abstracted from the folio edition by the author, laid out as 2 columns per page. The abridged version did not feature the literary quotes, just the author quoted. This made it cheaper to produce and buy. It sold over 1,000 copies a year for the next 30 years, bringing the dictionary to the reach of every literate home. Modern editions. Johnson's dictionary has been available in replica editions for some years. The entire first folio edition is available on a Dictionary of the English Language as an electronic scan. The preface to the dictionary is available on Project Gutenberg. In addition, a scan of the 6th 1785 edition can be found at the Internet Archive in its 2 volumes. Notes: ABUKCPI inflation numbers based on data available from Gregory Clark 2016, the annual RPI and average earnings for Britain, 1209-2. Present. New series. Measuringworth Carrot Bate, Walter Jackson Samuel Johnson, ch. 15, Storming the Main Gate, The Dictionary, New York, Harcourt Brace Jovanovich, 1975. Carrot Hitchings 2005, London P. Carrot Hitchings 2005, p. ISBN. Johnson's Dictionary, New York, Farrar, Strauss and Giroux. ISBN. Samuel Johnson Life and Topics. Birthplace, Home, and Museum. Early Life. Health. Edial Hall School. Dr. Johnson's House. The Club. Literary Criticism. Political Views. Religious Views. Samuel Johnson Prize. People. Francis Barber. James Boswell. David Garrick. John Hawkins. Arthur Murphy. Elizabeth Johnson. Wife. Henry Thrale. Hester Thrale. Anna Williams. Hodge. Essays and Periodicals. Birmingham Journal. The Gentleman's Magazine. The Idler. The Rambler. Biography and Criticism. Life of Mr. Richard Savage. Lives of the Poets. Miscellaneous Observations on the Tragedy of Macbeth. The Plays of William Shakespeare. Proposals for an edition of Shakespeare. Preface to Shakespeare. Miscellaneous Prose. A Journey to the Western Islands of Scotland. A Dictionary of the English Language. Letter to Chesterfield. Fiction and Poetry. Messiah Translation. London. Irene. The Vanity of Human Wishes. The History of Rasselas, Prince of Abyssinia. Contemporary Accounts. James Boswell's Life of Samuel Johnson. James Boswell's The Journal of a Tour to the Hebrides. John Hawkins' Life of Samuel Johnson. Arthur Murphy's Essay on the Life and Genius of Samuel Johnson. Hester Thrale's Anecdotes of the Late Samuel Johnson. Thraliana. Thomas Tyers. A Biographical Sketch of Dr. Samuel Johnson. V.E. Dictionaries of English. Old and Middle English and Anglo-Saxon Dictionary. Dictionary of Old English. Middle English Dictionary. Historic Catholicon. Anglicum 1483. The English Schoolmaster 1596. The New World of English Words 1658. A New English Dictionary 1702. And Universal Etymological English Dictionary 1721. A Dictionary of the English Language 1755. Webster's Dictionary 1820. 28th Century Dictionary 1889-91. American English. American Heritage Dictionary of American English. Dictionary of American Regional English. Imperial Dictionary. New Oxford American. Oxford American. Random House. Webster's. Webster's New World. Webster's Third. New International Dictionary. World Book Dictionary. British English. Chambers Collins. Oxford English. Concise Oxford English. Compact Oxford English. Shorter Oxford English. Historical Thesaurus. Oxford Dictionary of English. Penguin. Canadian English. Canadian Oxford Dictionary of Canadianisms. Gage. Canadian Full List. Australian English. Australian National. Australian Oxford. Macquarie Online. Wiktionary. Collaborative International Dictionary of English. OmegaWiki. Urban Dictionary. Wardnick Learners. ESL. Cambridge Advanced Learners. Collins Cobuild. Advanced Longman. Dictionary of Contemporary English. Macmillan English Dictionary for Advanced Learners. Merriam-Webster's Advanced Learners. Oxford Advanced Learners.